Nebraska Governor Pete Ricketts, who joins us. And I was looking, I was actually reading a piece over at my friend Jeff Dunance's website where he was discussing the new Second Amendment sanctuary proclamation that Governor Ricketts signed, stating that Nebraska is a Second Amendment sanctuary state and reaffirming the state's commitment to the right to keep and bear arms. And Texas is considering something like this. But I wish that we would get here in Texas constitutional carry first, you know, something with some teeth, which is what this proclamation has. By the way, Nebraska's even beaten Texas at this point. Governor, good to be with you. Thanks so much for joining us.
Well, thank you very much, Dana. I appreciate you having me on.
Of course. So talk to me about this, because there's some counties and states over the past couple of years that have designated themselves as being Second Amendment sanctuary counties. Of course, this is kind of a playoff on, you know, sanctuary states as it concerns illegal entry for the immigration issue. And in some of these states, and I've talked to some of the folks behind it, like in Illinois, for instance, really it's a proclamation for those counties where it's great to recognize it, but, you know, if push came to shove in the courtroom, it doesn't really give them more of an edge legally. Talk to me about this, because your situation is different. Nebraska does have teeth that goes along with this proclamation. So it's not just being a Second Amendment sanctuary state. There's also legislation in the works as well, as I understand. Tell me a little bit about what you are doing and why you felt the need to do this now.
Yeah. Well, when you look at the Biden administration, they've obviously been pushing a lot of bad policy. If you look at the 30 by 30 plan, the assault on the pro-life policies that the previous administration had, the immigration crisis that created the border. So this is just another in a series of terrible policies they're pushing by assaulting our Second Amendment rights. And with the proclamation, we're really doing three things. One, sending a message to the Biden administration that, hey, we're going to fight for our Second Amendment rights here in Nebraska, that we're not going to allow you to trample on our rights and think that we're just going to accept this. The second is that we, as you mentioned, have a number of counties, actually over half of our counties here in the state, have declared themselves Second Amendment sanctuary counties. But finally, we've got some important pro-Second Amendment legislation that's going on in our legislature right now, and this is helping to support that. So, for example, we've got a bill that would allow permitless concealed carry in our counties. So allow counties to be able to have permitless concealed carry. We've got concealed carry here in the state, but this would allow counties to be able to really kind of go one better. So there's a number of different things we're accomplishing by getting that proclamation out. But I think one of the big things is just letting our folks who, you know, love our Constitution, want to protect our Constitution, let them know that here in the state of Nebraska, we're on your side, that we're going to be protecting our Second Amendment rights. And despite what you hear from the national media or what you see out of coming to D.C., that here in the heartland, that we're going to be working to protect the Constitution.
Well, we're talking with Nebraska Governor Pete Ricketts, and it's good to hear that too, Governor, especially after everything that we've heard from the administration. They're looking to go after, even though we have the Undetectable Firearms Act of 1988. So there's, you know, people can't make and sell undetectable arms. That's what they call these ghost guns, etc. And it really does seem like they're trying to redefine what is a firearm and what isn't, so as to better control it and make everything technically an NFA item. It's good. I'm so glad that you have legislation that's going along with this, because I see other politicians and I see other leaders out there that say, oh, well, we're going to declare a Second Amendment sanctuary. But if we don't have anything in the works for permitless carry, aka constitutional carry, then, you know, for a lot of us, we're like, well, that's great. But, you know, what are we going to have to fall back on when the time comes, and it will, to litigate that? And so this is great. Although I am, Governor, I have to say, a little jealous that you're taking Nebraska here towards permitless carry before we get it in the Republic of Texas. So I have to judge you on that. I'm sorry.
Well, that's why our system of federalism is so great. It creates that healthy competition between states.
I'm going to try not to be salty over it, but I got family in Nebraska, so that's awesome that they'll be able to have that. You mentioned too and I want to touch on this really quickly, the administration's 30 by 30 plan, and for those who might be unaware, it's that goal that the Biden administration have of restricting something like 30% of land and water by 2030. And the majority, I mean, like over 95%, as I understand, of Nebraska's land is privately owned. How is that something that they're actually going to be able to do, considering there's so much private land ownership in your state?
Well, that's exactly what we've been asking the Biden administration. 97% about of our land is privately owned. And by the way, again, if you look at Nebraska, our farmers and ranchers were the original conservationists. They wanted to pass along that family farmer ranch to the next generation. So they took care of the land and their animals. Yeah. We manage our water resources here. Our Ogallala Aquifer is within 1% of where it was in the 1950s, even though we are the largest irrigated state in the country. We did all of that without federal help. We don't need the federal government coming here and telling us how to take care of our land, because we're doing it already through private ownership. Mm. And so when the Biden administration says we want to set aside 30%, we're like, well, you know, A, you don't have the constitutional authority to set aside 30%. And if you are working with Congress, what does this mean? Are you going to confiscate property from us? Are you going to, you know, how are you going to do that? And what's that going to mean for our rural communities when you undermine the tax base? How are schools and roads going to be paid for? Mm. So the Biden administration has, you know, come out with some of these policies and statements, but as we've seen in a variety of different settings, they aren't long on details. They don't want to tell you what they're doing. And, you know, for example, and I'll just draw the analogy with the immigration crisis they created, mm-hmm. at the border. They were in such a rush to undo some of these policies, and then they created, you know, 19,000 unaccompanied minors at the border, and they have no idea what to do. They had no idea how this was going to happen, though anybody they would have asked probably could have told them that was going to happen. And now they don't have any plan for how to handle it. And that's this, I believe that's probably what's going on with this 30 by 30. They've made this, you know, broad sweep of, I want to accomplish this policy, but they don't understand what's really going on here in the heartland and how it would impact us here. And so they're just forging ahead with really out giving us any information or even asking us our opinion.
That's just insane that they would propose such a broad policy and not even actually include any feedback from any of these, any governors of any state. That just seems like, it just seems so incredibly short-sighted. You mentioned a number of issues too, the immigration issue. One of the questions that I've always been interested in hearing from governors and AGs across the country, and we're speaking with Nebraska Governor Pete Ricketts, is all of the policies that are being proposed, whether it has to do with the nostalgic Green New Deal that they're looking at now, whether it has to do with Second Amendment issues, and for those just joining, we were talking with Governor Ricketts about Nebraska proclaiming to be a Second Amendment sanctuary state, and then they also have permitless carry working through their state legislature, which, did I ask, is what are the chances, sidebar to that, what are the chances of that passing, Governor?
Well, it hasn't come up for debate yet, so when it does, then we'll really get a good feel for where the body is going to go. As you may or may not know, Nebraska is very unique. We have a one-house legislature. Mm-hmm. It's called the unicameral. And it only takes 17 people to be able to block policy. So we're going to have a good fight on our hands to be able to get that pushed forward. Mm. But you know, having said that, it did get out of committee on a tough vote there. So just got to, you know, like anything else, nothing's ever easy. You got to work hard to be able to get it across the finish line.
That's true. And of course, I know that they'll probably try to, you know, scare everybody with manufactured, the Bloomberg groups out there with manufactured statistics about the crime that actually never occurs in any other of the other states where they pass constitutional carry. But the question before I sidetrack myself, right, Governor, we're talking to Governor Pete Ricketts in Nebraska. What really is ultimately, if something really just absolutely awful comes out of the administration, just, you know, just for the sake of discussion, some proposal that, you know, they're trying to enforce on states, and the idea of nullification, the state's right of nullification, at what point in your mind as governor of the state of Nebraska does that come into play? When you have, whether it's a Second Amendment infringing proposal, whether it's, as we were talking about with the administration's 30 by 30 plan, at what point do you go, you know, maybe we're at the time where we got to actually, you know, nullify some of the, we're going to exercise that right to do so as a state in this republic. At what point in your mind does that meet that?
Well, I think the first thing we do is really follow up on all the things we've got in place with regard to our legal options. Mm-hmm. Under the Obama administration, we, for example, I'll use the example of Waters of the U.S. The EPA was trying to greatly expand their power in ways that they did not have authority to do.
Oh, yeah.
And so even though that was something that everybody thought that this was going to happen, Working together with states like Texas, we took the Obama administration to court and got injunctions against the implementation of those laws, and were able to ultimately get the Obama administration left and the Trump administration came in and reworked that proposal such that it wasn't actually going to infringe upon our rights here in Nebraska. And so we got a much better rule out of it that actually stayed within the confines of the law and worked with what we wanted here in our state. So I think the first option for us is to pursue that, because we have a demonstrated track record of that working. Mm. That, you know, we've got the courts that will, you know, if we got to take, that's why it's so important that Trump put so many good judges on the bench.
Yes.
But we get good constitutional judges there, and then we take our case to those judges, and they go, well, this is what the law says, and, you know, Biden administration, you can't do this because the law doesn't say you can. So that's part of what we have to do. And then really what I'm expecting is, with the way this administration is really going so far overboard, and you think about the narrow leads they have in the House and the Senate, that even, you know, historically, generally you get the party that is not in the White House makes gains.
Mm-hmm.
I expect that we've got to go to the American people and recapture the House and the Senate in next year's election, and then we can start making progress on undoing some of this bad policy that they're proposing, and certainly stopping it before it gets through the legislature. And then 4 years from now, replacing this administration with one that is going to help protect our rights and not take away, confiscate our property, not confiscate our guns, you know, that sort of thing. That's what we ultimately have to do. So I think there's a lot of opportunities here. I don't think we have to go to nullification yet. I think we got lots of great opportunities that really work through the current exit system that we got to try first.
Yeah. No, it's a good plan. It's a good plan, and it's worked. As you said, I've been successful at it before. It's crazy to see so many things from the Obama era, like, you know, whether it's Bureau of Land Management or some of these things through the EPA and these other proposals, kind of come back to being in vogue in Washington, D.C. now that Biden's in office. It's kind of surreal to watch. Governor Pete Ricketts of Nebraska, always good to talk with state leaders, and we appreciate your time with us today. We look forward to talking with you again soon, sir. Thank you for your time.